Good evening, folks. Give you all a very warm word of welcome to our midweek tonight, and a special word of welcome to Keith Lindsay. Keith's no stranger to us. Lovely to have you with us again, Keith, sharing the work of Acre. Just to say the retiring offering tonight will be going towards Acre. Do remind committee men and elders that we have a quick committee meeting afterwards. We'll have it over this side here, okay? We'll have a quick committee meeting afterwards and that. We're going to praise God as we sing together, "Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word." Let's join together in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to praise you that you are the God who speaks to us. Unless you chose to reveal yourself, we would never know you. And we praise you that you have come to speak because you're the God who wants to know us and for us to know you. We praise you, Father, that you made us for this purpose. We think of Adam and Eve in the cool of the day, how they would have walked with you. And what a lovely thought. They walked with you in perfect fellowship. Nothing to spoil it. Nothing to interrupt it. And yet, Father, then we see their sin and how that relationship was broken. But, Father, we think immediately that when Adam and Eve were clothed with the skin of that animal, it just pointed forward to the sacrifice for sin who would be your son, who would come to die to be our peace so we could have that friendship with you once more. And Father, we thank you that through Jesus we can know you. Through Jesus you speak to us. Through Jesus we can have this relationship. And Father, we thank you that one day we will enter heaven's glory through Christ. And on that day, Father, we will be, as a human race, back into that perfect relationship. how glorious that will be. But Father, thank you that even now we can know so much of you through Christ and through your Spirit and through your Word. Father, we rejoice in our relationship with you, our knowledge of you, our knowledge of your salvation in Christ. And yet we are aware of so many in our community, so many within the continent of Europe, so many within this world who don't know Christ, some who haven't even heard of him. And so, Father, we want to thank you for the work that you're doing through Acre, whether it be in Brazil, in the Canaries, in Portugal, wherever, Lord. And we just pray that tonight as Keith comes among us, that you would bless him, that you would just stir us up, Father, to how we can be involved in this vital work in prayer and support. And also, Father, give us a fresh heart for the gospel and reaching out. I just pray for Keith. I just pray too for his wife, not so well at this time, that you'd be unto her all that she needs. Just surround them with your love and your goodness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Keith, just hand over to yourself.
Well, lovely. Hope this holds me. Lovely to be back with you tonight again. Thank you for the opportunity to come and share about the work of Acre. We feel very much at home whenever we come to Brookside. All these familiar faces down there, and it's lovely to be here to share again this evening about the work of Acre. And thank you at the very beginning for your prayers and for your support as a church. You support the work of Acre, and we really do appreciate that very, very much. Thank you. And we do pray that the Lord will bless you for that and encourage you. And as you see what's happening in the work tonight, that you'll be encouraged and blessed as well through what the Lord is doing. We give the Lord thanks. If you have a Bible with you, we're going to turn just for a couple of verses to Genesis 22. And we were singing there about the promises, resting on God's promises, just in that last verse of the hymn. Genesis 22, it's a familiar passage, I'm sure, to us tonight, the one that I particularly love to read and think about. And it's the story, of course, of Abraham and Isaac and how God steps into Abraham and Sarah's life. And God promises that he will give them a son. And of course, they get impatient along the way, don't they? Yet God fulfills his promise to them. And Isaac is born. And then as we read into chapter 22, we see that God comes again to Abraham. And it tells us there at the very beginning, and it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham, or God tested Abraham. And it wasn't his first test of faith, it was nearly his last test of faith. I believe that God had got him to the place where he knew he could trust him with this test of faith. And God came to him, and as we know the account, I'm sure, so well, God said to Abraham, I want you to take your son, Isaac, I want you to build an altar, and I want you to sacrifice him for me. And then again, we read through the account here, and we get to verse 14. And Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. And the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time and said, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, because thou hast done this thing and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying, I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is upon the seashore. And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. Just two words that I want to leave as we go into the presentation here this evening. Those two words, Jehovah Jireh. And again, for Abraham, Jehovah Jireh, God provided, didn't he? God provided a lamb, a ram, caught in the thicket by its horns. There had to be a blood sacrifice. And of course, it was a spotless lamb. Now, I'm not a farmer. You'll all know that. You'll not be shaking my hands on the way out, but I've got very liquid hands. You know what they are? Hands that do dishes. Under the thumb husband, that means, okay? I'm not a farmer by any means, but it was a spotless lamb. It was a perfect lamb. And of course, nothing but a perfect sacrifice could be made to a holy God. And Isaac came off the altar, and the lamb was put in his place, or the ram was put in his place. Isaac couldn't have died. Why? Because he was a sinner, wasn't he? But the lamb took his place. God kept his promise to Abraham. And of course, as we look through that account, we see how it typifies very much how God kept his promise to all of us. Because God promised that he would send a savior into the world to Adam and Eve whenever they disobeyed God in the Garden of Eden. And God fulfilled that promise in the savior of the world being born, the Lord Jesus Christ. The one who came to be that once for all sacrifice for sin forever as he would go to the cross and as he would pay the debt for you and me that we could never, ever pay. What a wonderful God we have today. One who continues to keep his promises to us. And as I look back over the work of ACRI over 85 years, now I'm not that old yet, all right, but as I look back in the history of the work of ACRI, we have so much, and I say this and every time I speak, we have so much to thank the Lord for in God's faithfulness, in God fulfilling his promises right down through the years, for his promises, for his protection, for his provision for the mission. We really do thank the Lord for every single thing that he has done. And we give him all the glory and all the praise tonight because he is the one who is worthy. And again, as I said, as we look back, do I need to hit this? No, that's it. As we look back over the years, we're thankful for all those who serve the Lord with us. Many that have gone home to glory, to their reward. Some that are still with us. I know a number of people pray for Dr. Bill Woods. Bill has just returned from Brazil. He's only 85. He's only a wee young fella. But Bill has, and again, I've probably mentioned this before when I've been here, Bill has had cancer for the last 11 or 12 years and been having treatment, a chemotherapy every month. But just when he came back from Brazil there a couple of weeks ago, he was told that his chemotherapy isn't working anymore and the treatment's not working anymore. And so please do pray for him as they're trying another concoction of drugs on him to try and get his red blood cells back up and the white blood cells back down again. So please pray for him that the Lord will just touch him and help him. And Bill has done an amazing work in Brazil over the years. The leprosy program that he started way back about 40 years ago, God has blessed through that. And 98% of leprosy has been obliterated out of the state of Acre because of what God has done through a young fella from Belfast who never passed an exam in his life, who went to Brazil to serve him. Just recently, well, in recent years, when Bill was out tramping through the forests, getting out of the canoe, maybe walking 5 or 6 hours into the heart of the forest to reach people with medicines, he realized that there were people that got these huge lesions all over their bodies. It looks a wee bit like cauliflower growing out of their body. And he realized there was something wrong. He tried leprosy medicine, thinking it maybe was some type of leprosy. But then as he looked into that, he realized it was a thing called George Lobos disease. And through a concoction of medicines, through leprosy medicine and other medicines, Bill actually found the cure for this particular disease. And as he gave and administered these medicines, the lesion started to come off folk, disappear. He contacted, of course, the health authorities there in Brazil, and they looked into it all, went to America and so on, and just recently that has been released, the money and funding has been released for that medicine to be able to help so many folk there in the Acre state and Amazonas as well. When he was in Brazil, he was invited to go to the south of Brazil to a big presentation there. He didn't go. He said, I'm not interested in all these presentations and accolades that men give me. He said, that's not what it's about. He said, what I want to do is hear the Lord say one day, well done, Bill Woods. And that's the type of person that he is. And so his all been written up, and it's going into the medical journals in America. It's going into the medical journals here in Europe as well about this find that he has found there just recently. So please pray for him that the Lord will continue to touch him and strengthen him and help him as he serves the Lord. And he's talking now about going back to Brazil again. And so once he's got the bug to go back, there's no stopping him. He is very bad on his feet. He's not very mobile. But he said, I felt like the king going through the airports because I was pushed through the airports and I was treated like royalty. So that's Bill Wood. So please continue to remember him in prayer. I could talk about so many of the other workers. And I know that the last time I was probably here speaking in the church, I shared about the work in Brazil in the Northeast and how God has been really blessing there. And for your encouragement, we are so excited about what God is doing in the Northeast of Brazil today. We now have 13 pastors and their wives and families serving the Lord with us there. I think I mentioned the last time I was here about a new church build that we had done. This time last year, some of our friends who helped me with craft work, and we sell it and then the money goes into projects and the work, I said to them, have we any money to buy a piece of ground in the northeast of Brazil? And they looked at me and said, what? Well, haven't that much money, don't be daft. And I said, well, it's £3,000. And they said, well, that's exactly just what we have in the account. So we were able to buy the piece of ground in the northeast of Brazil in a place called Cerro do Doctor. There, Pastor Iran, one of our pastors, it's one of his other churches, his main church is in Campo Redondo, but he was working there for the last 5 years. He started off in the market, going to the market and sharing the gospel in the market with the stallholders, the fruit and vegetable, and it's a big, big thing, the markets there in Brazil. And then he went around every home in that town of Cerro do Doctor with literature, sharing the gospel. Then he rented a garage with a roller shutter door, and that's where church started, in the garage. And as I said, he said to me about finding this piece of ground, and this time last year, just at the end of June, I was in a church, and I happened to say that we had bought the piece of ground, and I said, someday we hope to have a church built there. And a man rang me on the Sunday after the Wednesday night, and he said, how much is it to build a church in Brazil? I said, well, it's between 15 and 20,000. He said, is that all? You couldn't build a garage, he said, here for that. So he said, you know, I want to leave a legacy for God. And folks, it really challenged my heart, I have to say that. He said, I want to leave a legacy for God. He said, I can leave my money to my family and they'll blow it. They'll have a great time and they'll buy all the things they want to buy and so on. He said, but I want to send the 20,000 to build that church to the glory of God. And so he sent the money through, and the church was opened just towards the end of October. It didn't take long to build it. Whenever I was sending him through reports of what was happening, he kept saying to me, could you send a few of them boys over to Northern Ireland? Because maybe we'd get a bit of building work done if you had them here. So amazing. And we've just put a new pastor and his wife and family into that church, Pastor Marcelo and his wife and family. And please pray for them as they settle into the area, as they reach out with the gospel, that we'll see many more folk coming to know Christ as their personal savior these days. One of our other pastors, Pastor Diego, a lovely guy, him and his wife, Susanna, and their two kids. They worked in a place called São Paulo de Potengi. I always say you need your teeth in to say these names. São Paulo de Potengi, he's been there for 9 years serving the Lord there, a great young man. He came to us before Christmas time and he said, the Lord has called me to another church. That's what you don't want to hear sometimes. And he said, I'm going to have to leave the mission because it's not even here in Rio Grande do Norte, this state. It's in the state below, Paraíba, another state. And so Victor Maxwell and I talked about it and prayed about it, and we felt we should say to him, look, you don't need to leave the fellowship of the mission. Maybe the Lord's opening a new door for us. The Lord's opening another state for us in the Northeast. And so he said, that's the answer I wanted. That's what I wanted to hear. He said, I'm so delighted, and he's part of our mission, and he's working in a place called Sousa. A new work there. God is really blessing and encouraging him. He's working alongside also CEF there, a PECI that they're called in Brazil, and working with the children and the young people and seeing a great work done for God there. It was very sad, not long after he went, just back in February, March time, that the news came through. He sent us through a report of a lovely lady in his church, a lady who was so on fire for God. And he said she was saved and she really wanted to reach her family for Christ. And he said it was so heartbreaking because her son, who was 14, got a gun and shot her. Shot his brother, his sister, and also himself. He was 14. And the aftermath of that, of course, as well. And the difficulties of that, facing that as a minister, a pastor in a church, it's difficult. And, well, do pray for that whole family circle as he's trying to be a real witness to them. She was the only one saved in her whole family, that lady. And she was trying to witness to her family. And we're praying that through this tragedy that God will bring triumph and glory to his name. We're hoping, God willing, to have Diego here in November for our autumn break in the Killyhevelin and maybe a few other meetings as well later on in the year. So we're hoping to do that. We're just planning and talking about that yesterday as well. So thank you for praying for Brazil. I'm not going to speak any more about it. I'm going to talk a wee bit about Lanzarote, because I was here with the youth fellowship and I was speaking about Lanzarote, I think, to them. So if there's any young folk here tonight, you're going to hear it again. I apologize for that. But Lanzarote is a great place. It's a place that's very much on our hearts. And maybe some of you, anybody ever been to Lanzarote for their holidays? A few of you. Okay, then you know what it's like out there. It's about just over 4 hours flight from here. And we weren't there from 2019, of course, because of the pandemic. Karen and I were there just a number of weeks back. We were out to plan our summer team going out and our camp there. Population of Lanzarote is about 150,000 people. 9,500 British people, or just a bit over that. 4,580 Colombian people. There's a lot of Colombians on the island there. 4,400 German, 4,380 Moroccan, 18,000 others, and 110,000 Spanish folk. So that makes up the population of that little island that you can drive around in just a few hours. An amazing place, amazing folk. We absolutely love the work out there. You know, people think of Lanzarote, it's a holiday destination. You go and you lie on the beach or you lie at the pool in your hotel and you enjoy the sunshine and the heat there all year round, and that's what they love to do. Whenever it gets to 20 degrees there, they put their coats on. Whenever it's 20 degrees out there, we take our clothes off and lie by the pool, isn't that right? You can imagine. Whenever they come over here, they're absolutely foundered. This is Pastor Ricardo and his wife Sandra, who are our workers there. They moved to Lanzarote way over 20 years ago from Colombia. Ricardo went first to get a house and to get work before Sandra and the children would come. And he was a believer. They were both believers. They got saved out in Colombia. And he was walking past the church, which is the other photograph there. He was walking past the church one day, and he was just sort of looking about it. And the next thing, this arm pulled him inside. And it was a guy called Jonathan Ray, not the motorbike rider. Jonathan Ray is a pastor of Glengormley Baptist Church, and Johnny and his wife Carolina worked out there in Lanzarote alongside our mission at that time. And Johnny said, "You're looking for a church? Well, then you're going to come here." And that's how he started to go to the church. So if you stand at the gates of the church out here on Sunday and anybody goes past, just pull them in, all right, and see what happens. But amazing opportunities there in the church. God is really building his church there. It's been amazing to see what the Lord is doing over the years. Ricardo became the pastor there about 7 years ago, and they're a great, great couple, and they have great vision and a great passion for the work and to reach out there to the community, and we really are so thankful. So if you go to Lanzarote and you go to the main bus station, which is in Arrecife, if you look behind the bus station, that's what you'll see, the church, and you'll see the cross there on the tower. And that's where we're heading now in just over a week's time to take a team out there with us. This is us just a few weeks ago. We were out after church for supper with the elder Elkin in the green there at the back, and his wife Nora and their daughter Lara, and then Ricardo and Sandra. And the young guy in the black with the glasses, I probably asked you to pray for him the last time I was here. His name is Danny. He is Ricardo and Sandra's son. And whenever we were there 3 years ago, he was always involved with the team, always with the team, 24/7, slept in with the team and everything else. But there was something wrong. There was something different. He never came out of his room. He locked himself away and he covered the windows that his room was black and dark and was in a very, very dark, dark place. We were very concerned about him. He spoke to his mother about looking at sights, how to take his life, and so on. And we had the country praying for this young man, Danny, that God would really touch him and help him, and that some light would shine in his heart. He was a lovely young lad, lovely young believer who was serving the Lord in the church. He went to mainland Spain to do medicine, couldn't cope, had to leave, and so on and so on. And it's a long story. But I would love you to take that wee man, that wee young fella, on your heart, and I'd love you to really pray for Danny too, that God will really miraculously touch him. And it was lovely for us whenever we were there that he came out of the room and he came and he hugged us and he spent time with us whenever we were there, and came out with us that night. And his mom and dad said, "It's a miracle that he's actually come out to the house to Elkin and Norris House with us. It's a miracle because he doesn't do that. We went out for a meal together and he also came with us. And that's big, big steps for Danny. And we just love him. And he's like a son to us. And we just love him. And we're just so concerned for him that the Lord will just touch him. And please pray for him. Now, this is the last team we had out. We had 22 in the team. We're not taking as big a team out this time. I haven't a photograph, obviously, of the team yet. They're meeting in our house tomorrow night to plan and prepare for going out. But we're so thankful for young people that take of their time to come and share with us. And again, as I said, this was one of the best teams we've ever had. Great young folk. We're willing just to serve whatever way that you ask them and get stuck into the work there. And we had a fantastic team the last time. But as I said, we're taking a team out. There's just 9 on the team going out. Karen was to come as well, but she's been unwell and been in hospital and will not be able to come with me this time. And she's lying up today at home and she said, I'm really worried. And I said, what's wrong with you now? She said, you have nobody to cook. Now, you know, looking at me, I'll not starve, isn't that right? Maybe a bit of starving wouldn't do me any harm. And I said, well, we have a chef coming with us, another girl who cooks, and another girl who cooks, so there's plenty of cooks, and we'll definitely not starve. And there's a bakery across the road from the church, so we'll be fine. But she's very concerned about this and thinks we're going to starve the children who come to camp as well, because she's not there to dictate and tell me what to do or tell everybody what to do. However, do pray for us because we leave here on the 27th. That's Monday week. We head off. We just got an email at 11:30 the other night to say that our flight to London was cancelled because we're going the cheapest way we can. So we have to fly to London and then fly from London on. So the flights to Gatwick were cancelled. And so the young folk frantically got on and we all got booked. The sad thing is I got the short straw. I have to leave at 6:00 in the morning, which means I have to be in the airport before 4:00. So that's great news for me. But some of the other young people are coming with me and then the rest will meet up there in Gatwick and fly out then on the 27th evening to Lanzarote. The first week's involved in preparation for camp, getting all the craft materials, memory verses, Bible lessons, everything prepared for camp. Plus there's a prayer meeting on Tuesday night in the church. There's a Bible study on Thursday night in the church. And then there's children's clubs as well. So we have a lot of preparation to do whenever we get over there. We're also on the Thursday, Friday, and Saturday mornings doing coffee mornings at the church. Now, that's a normal thing for here in Northern Ireland. We wouldn't think twice about a coffee morning, but it's a very new thing for the folk there. And about 5 years ago, we talked to them about this, and we put up the gazebos in the backyard of the church and tables and chairs, and they made Northern Ireland tray bakes. You can't beat them. Again, that's something that they don't get out there. It's very hard sometimes to source the stuff, but anyway, we try. And what an opportunity for people that live in the neighborhood to come in. We put out over 1,000 invitations around the homes. Now, we only got maybe 7, 8, 9, 10 people that came in, but an opportunity to reach someone with the gospel. And please pray for this outreach, that God will really bless in it, and that the folk in the church will be really encouraged as they come along to sit with folk and talk with folk as well, that will really see new people being brought into the church. New folk coming in under the sound of the gospel during that time. Also in the plazas, we have kids' clubs. We're used to CEF doing that here at home, aren't we? Getting the ground sheet and taking it out and putting it down in someone's garden maybe, in an estate, and doing a children's club. We do that in the plazas out there. You know, one of the plazas there, the first one that you see in the picture, there's a lot of Muslim children come to that. And the mothers will sit with their burqas on, and you just see the eyes coming out through. And, you know, as we play with the kids, do games with them first, and then have that time of singing and Bible lesson and memory verse and so on with them, it's amazing that those mothers allow their kids to come and sit and listen. And again, many of them that are hearing the gospel, most of them that are hearing the gospel for the very first time, please pray for that. Sunday services and the involvement in the work in the church there as well, the team will be involved in that. Whenever we were back there, we just said it was just like coming home. That's what it felt like. It was so lovely to be back and be part of the work there and part of the church. And they're such great, great people. And do pray for the team as they take part. One of the couples who are come with us, they just got married a couple of weeks ago. And they've already had their honeymoon, but they're having another honeymoon with us in Lanzarote. Emily has been with us quite a few times on the team and involved in that. And Luke, he'll be preaching at one of the services. I'll be preaching at the other services. And do remember us as we take part and the team take part in the services. As they sing as well, again, these are just pictures of the last team. But it's great to take the story of the good news of the gospel to people who have never, ever heard. We do beach outreach. The last time we just got a few kids to come, I think parents were quite concerned about who we were, maybe suspicious of who we were. We're hoping to go down with flyers to the beach first. And again, because of all the COVID restrictions as well, we're not sure how this is going to go this time, but we're going to try it and see. And once you get that big parachute out and all the different colors, then you see the kids coming along to be involved in that. We also, the second week, have camp. That's what we're doing all the preparation for the first week. Second week, we have camp. This year, we're at church. Again, because of restrictions, we're not keeping the children overnight. We have them from 10 in the morning to 6 o'clock at night. And then at 7 o'clock, the youth come, the teenagers come, and the young people come. And we have movie nights and lots of other activities with them. This is one of the movie nights just out in the backyard of the church. And the kids and young folk just love to be able to do that. As I said, the camp, please pray for it. We normally are in a camp center, which is a Catholic retreat center. Actually, it's the only place to have camp in Lanzarote. Don't throw me out because of that. In the chapel, we had to use it because we had so many. We had over 50 kids at the last camp, and then all of our leaders as well, and then the Spanish folk who were there. So there's nearly 100 of us there. And we just turned all the pews around that we weren't looking at the crucifix and the statues. And we asked if we could move them, and the priest went berserk and told us if we touched them, we would be in for it. So we have to respect that as well. And it's a great center. It's right in the center of Lanzarote, in the middle of nowhere. The kids can shout and bawl and roar and run about as much as they want. It's safe for them. And again, they're not affecting anyone or annoying anyone beside them. And again, in the meetings, just like here, we're involved in singing and involved in teaching them memory verses. We feel it's so important to get the Word of God implanted in their hearts. And also sword drill, which they had never done before. And to see them nearly killing each other, to get up, to get first at the sword drill, it's amazing. And of course, the Bible lessons, which are so vitally important as we teach them. This year, we're going to do the wordless book again, because the majority of children we have never heard anything. Anything. We can't really comprehend that, can we, coming from this part of the world? But they know nothing of the gospel. They know nothing about God. And the last time, we prayed very much that we would have Bibles for every child, because the year before at camp, there weren't enough Bibles to go around. They were sharing them. And that was one of our great burdens last year, that every single child will go home with a copy of God's Word. And we're so thankful for that we bought 50 Bibles, just over 50 Bibles, and every child went home with a copy of God's Word. And when we were there a few weeks ago, one of the mothers had one of those Bibles. And I tell you, it was well used. And it really thrilled me to see it. And I was trying to get a wee sneaky photograph of it that I could show folk, but I didn't manage to get it. She caught me on. And so I didn't get the photograph. Maybe whenever we go back, we'll get that. We have a barbecue the last night of camp for the parents, again, which is so important because you're breaking down barriers with people. You're getting them in to the church yard at the back, and then we invite them again on the Sunday, let their kids take part. Some of the things that we would probably do here. That was the camp there at the camp center, and please, we do very much value your prayers for that. The young folk, of course, enjoy life as well. And we take them to see the camels and the volcanoes and all these other bits and pieces. There they are. The man just looked at me and he said, "Camel? No." You can imagine why. I didn't want to kill it. We have a wee short video here. I can talk forever, as you know, but this is just camp 2019. And again, something of what we'll be doing over the next couple of weeks whenever we're away there. Many of these kids come from very difficult backgrounds. Social services send them to us as well. I was so blind. My sin was before me. I was swallowed by pride. But out of the darkness, you brought me to your light. Well, that just gives you a wee taste of what we'll be doing and helps you to pray. Very, very quickly, just to take you to Portugal, just for a moment. Portugal, again, a very needy country. Just over 11 million people that live in Portugal. 0.04%. Did you hear that? 0.04% of the population of 11 million are evangelical. It's a very hard, difficult, needy country. We've just heard of a couple who are coming home from Portugal as missionaries because it's so difficult. There's one of the pastors in Brazil who's been a pastor for many years in a very big church in Brazil, was over there about 7 years ago. He went over to Portugal to work. He felt the Lord calling him to leave Manaus in the Amazon, big church there, to go to Portugal. They stuck it for 3 years. His health was so bad and his wife's health was so bad, they had to leave and go back because it was so, so difficult and so hard against the gospel. Araldo and Emanuel Arias are two of our workers there. They work in a place called Santo André, which is not the Algarve. Maybe some of you have been to the Algarve for your holidays. It's the next region up, the Alentejo, and it's between the Algarve and Lisbon, and that's where they work. That's the little church there. And it's amazing, again, to see what God has been doing there in that particular area. Araldo is from Brazil originally. Emanuela is from France. They met here in Northern Ireland. They met at language school in Belfast. I think Rupert Stanley College in Belfast they met at. And she asked him to go to the pub, and he asked her to go to the Bible study in the Crescent Church, Derek Bingham at the time. And he said, there was no way I was going to the pub. And she said, well, there's no way I'm going to the Bible study. I have nothing to do with God. But God worked in her life, and she went to the Bible study, and eventually she trusted the Lord. And it's an amazing story. They've been working there for 30 years out there in Portugal. And that's their little church in Santo André. Again, as I said, the Lord has been really blessing there in the work. But we were just a couple of weeks ago back in May time, the team were in Fatima. And I know that you have heard about Fatima before, and you've been praying for Fatima and praying for our teams who are going there. I couldn't go because we had Brazilians here doing meetings with them, so I wasn't able to go this time. I was so looking forward to going actually out to Portugal to see the workers there because of not being there for the last 3 years. But again, you see something of the vastness of the crowds here, probably 600,000-700,000 people. And again, because of COVID restrictions, they haven't been there. In their droves like this for the last 2-3 years. But they were back this year again, so many people, and the teams had great opportunities. That's the candlelit mass you see there. And I always say, whenever you see all those lights, that behind all those thousands and thousands of lights are lost souls that need a Savior. And it's a privilege for our teams to go and to go out into the roads, because many people walk to the shrine. Some are walking for days and weeks to come there, walking in their bare feet. The more they walk, the more pain that they suffer. Going to the shrine, then they believe that Mary will answer their prayers for them. So the more they do, the more that their prayers will be answered. And our teams have the opportunity to go out to the roads to give them bottles of water. We go to where there's a huge hill coming up, and you can imagine the heat. Jeff was saying it was over 30 degrees whenever they were there. He said it was absolutely boiling hot. And so they were glad of a nice cool bottle of water, but also the Word of God. And we have Gospels of Luke, we have Gospels of John, we have the testimony of converted priests and nuns. We have different literature that we give out there. And again, we know that God's Word does not return unto him void. And again, Araldo has had many contacts of people down through the years that have asked for more literature, they've asked for Bibles and so on and so on, because they've been reached there at Fatima. We were also just on the 10th last week, isn't it? Last week, that was the 10th of June. They had Children's Day at Fatima. I have no pictures of it up here, but they had Children's Day there. Whenever there's probably in the region of 200,000 children are shipped in from all over, bussed in from all over Portugal to come to the shrine, where they hear the story of the shepherd children and how they saw this apparition of Mary and how the whole thing was started. And it's all a money racket, folks, because you pay for everything at it. And whenever we're giving the water to them, they're going, how much? And we're saying, it's free. They say, it can't be free. The literature, it can't be free, because they pay for everything whenever they go there. Even the little prayers of Mary and so on, They pay for all of that stuff. And there's thousands of people walking the roads, but it's a great opportunity of getting the gospel out. And we have a team going in October. We have another team, two teams are going again going next year, God willing. And if you'd be interested in coming on a team with us, I said in a meeting one time, I was speaking in the Faith Mission Convention in Edinburgh one year, and I happened to say, if you can walk and breathe, you can come with us. So a lady came to me afterwards and she said, I'm 74. I can walk and breathe. Can I come? She was from Liverpool. I said, you'd be very welcome. And Marianne traveled on her own. She got a bus to Manchester, got a flight from Manchester across. We picked her up at the airport. And on her 80th birthday, she was still coming with us to Portugal. So, folks, as I look around, you're not all too old to come. All right. But if you'd be interested in that, we'd love you to come and join us for Fatima, for that outreach. And again, that's just a picture of the vastness. You can't even see it. And I was speaking to, we had our youth barbecue on Saturday night, and I was speaking to one of the girls who was there, and she said, you know, the pictures, they really don't tell what it's really like to stand there in the vastness of that place. Our son and his wife were in Rome there recently, and he was on the phone with me, and he said, Dad, I thought that this would be a huge place like Fatima. And he said, it's far, far smaller than Fatima is, St. Peter's Square. It's such a vast, vast place. I'd love you to pray for this couple just as I finish, because this is one of the Brazilians who was with us. His name is Jander. His family are a very, very special family to us. Back in March time, we had his grandmother, his three aunts, and his uncle with us staying in our home. During the storms of March, if you remember them back then, we took them to the North Coast because they were only here for a number of days and they wanted to see all of Northern Ireland and everything that there was to show them. And we took them up to the North Coast, and his grandmother, she's only about that height. I'm not joking. We had to hold her down because we thought she was going to get blew away, because the water was coming over at Ballantoy Harbour right over the top of the wee house and everything else. It was wild, and they were loving it because they live in Manaus. The only way I can describe that is sitting in a sauna. 30 degrees is probably a cooler day for them. And, we're really thankful for these families. The D'Souza family, they have two Christian schools. His mum was actually the principal of one of the schools. And, again, his aunt is the principal of the other school, or the owners of the schools. And we're so thankful for these families and for what they do. They have over 600 children every day that are being taught the gospel. Isn't that amazing? And to stand at 7:30 in the morning and listen to these children recite scripture, it does your heart good. It really does. It just moves you. And that's them. Well, anyway, Jander was over. They were in Europe. They were over in Portugal beforehand. And Jander and his wife, Rebecca. Rebecca is the pastor's daughter, so Jander has to look after her well. And their little daughter there, Mariana, is just 3-4 months old. They're going to be leaving Manaus, and they're going to be moving to Portugal, God willing, in the springtime. A brilliant couple, very gifted couple. Will you pray for them? It's not like Brazil. It's very different. And where they're going to three little churches, Serpa, Beja, Cuba, and Vale dos Mortes, is four different churches, but one of them there's a pastor in. They're going to work in those three churches. Vale dos Mortes, it means the valley of the dead. So you can imagine what it's like. Two people in one of those churches. There's four in one of the other churches. Two of them are in a nursing home. And the other church is about to close as well. And they're coming over to work in these areas. Difficult, difficult areas. And they need our prayers. And I would love you to pray for them, that the Lord will bless them, encourage them, that the Lord will go before them. Jander, when he was here, got an email from his work. He is a civil engineer, and he got an email from his work, from his company, to say, you need to come back next week. Well, he couldn't because he was in Europe, and he couldn't get back. And whenever he got back to Portugal there just over a week ago, they said, sorry, you've got the sack. You've no job left. So the church there, the Hebron church that we're involved with, they said, well, come and be an assistant pastor with us. You'll be going to Portugal next year. You're finishing your Bible college. Just come and work alongside us for the next number of months before you go to Portugal. So we very much value prayer for them. They're a great, great couple, great family, and we would love you to pray for them. just in finishing, the magazines are already out there on the table. As I say, they're not ornaments. Please take one with you and read about what God is doing. It's a Brazil edition. The young folk that we have working alongside us now at home, they're designing a new magazine that's coming out in August, a new cover and all the rest of it. So that's been in the process at the moment. And also we have our Acre Kids magazine. This has gone down a real blessing. Mariana, who works with Jeff and Mariana, they're just about to have a baby any of these days. They're just waiting and holding their breath, thinking it'll come today, and it doesn't. So you know what it's like, some of you. So please remember them in prayer and for the little baby. As it'll be born before the weekend, that's all we know. But Mariana's involved in this, Acre Kids magazine. And this is part five, but it's been the story of Dr. Bill Woods all through it. And if you want one of them or you want a series of these, you can get that from us. The email address is on that as well. Do take the prayer letter with you too. And then just on Monday night coming, if you're free, at 8 o'clock on Facebook, or Nosybook as we call it, and also on YouTube, we have Mission Matters. And the pastor who was with us, Pastor Herbert, Jander is his son-in-law. Pastor Herbert has been interviewed by Victor Maxwell. And Jander will actually be speaking at the end of that as well. So if you're free to have a look at it, or you can get it on catch-up, have a look at that as well. Just to say again, thank you so much for praying for us. Thank you so much for standing with us in the work. We really, really do appreciate it, and we know the Lord will continue to bless you as you continue to serve him here in a hall. Thank you.
Kate, just before you go, one question. The teams that go out to Portugal, to Lanzarote, do you have to be able to speak Portuguese or Spanish to go on those teams?
Absolutely not.
So,
no. As long as you can speak English, you're
all right. Well, that might rule some out, but anyway. So, as long as you're brief and you're able to go. So, let's pray together. Father, just thank you so much for all that Keith has been able to share, and just praise you for the work that's going on across the world. And Lord, just thank you for what we've heard once more about Bill Woods, Lord, an amazing man by your grace. And I just, Father, pray you continue to be with him, and just that he would know your peace, Lord, in these days, and just undertake for his every need. We just pray, Father, for those who are serving out there. We pray for Diego, Lord, that he would know your grace and leading, and just bless the churches out there in Brazil. And Lord, we just pray that indeed that the kingdom would just grow in power in their midst. Father, we pray for the team going out to Lanzarote, Lord. We just thank you for this team going out. Just pray that we would be, by your grace, united and just undertake for them. And we just pray against the evil one who will always seek to disrupt. And we just pray, Father, that indeed for the kids' clubs, for the outreach work, for the camp, you would undertake. And Lord, we just pray too, even for some of the kids' clubs and the beach, that, Father, that you'd draw many kids along to that. And Lord, that you'd open up the door for the gospel in their hearts. We just pray for this young fella, Danny, Lord. Just pray that your grace and peace will be so near and so real to him. And that's this time, Father. We pray for Portugal, Father. It's just so sad to hear just such a tiny proportion of that population that know you. Thank you, Father, for all that was done at Fatima. And thank you for those who have received the literature and the Gospels. And even, Father, tonight, that they would just find that literature and be reading it. And through the power of your Spirit, draw them to Christ and to salvation. We just pray, Father, for Jander and his wife as they prepare to go out, Lord, and for others who are serving you there. We just pray, Father, that you would have mercy upon that nation, mercy upon those people. And, Lord, that you would be drawing them unto Christ and salvation in these days. Oh, Lord, that you would build your church, and the gates of hell would not prevail against it. Lord, just be with Keith and Karen, Lord, and all that are involved, and just meet their every need. And may they continue to know your grace being wonderfully sufficient. We ask it all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thank you very much, Keith. And do remind you of the literature on the way out. Do pick up the magazines and do read it and use it to pray. And do please do that and remember the offerings for Acre. Also, just remind you that we sign up sheets for the Holy Bible Club and also the Fun Night. It's been really encouraging, the numbers so far, and a bit more would be very helpful. So please, particularly the Holy Bible Club, we need help for that, young and old alike. As long as you're breathing, you can help in that. So that's a good expression, that. Just also to say that next week we have Phil Dunn from EMF coming, and I'm sure we'll get a wee update on Ukraine and that next week, just to remind you that. And just to say that in 2 weeks' time, we'll be moving back into the minor hall for the midweeks. Now, they'll not be live streamed and that, so we just, hopefully some of them will be able to record the messages, but we will keep a wee area at the back for those who want to wear a mask and a wee bit of distance in that. But so 2 weeks' time, beginning of July, moving back into the minor hall for our midweeks. Coming back to some sort of normality at this time. We're going to conclude now with a lovely hymn just to stir us up. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of God the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.